Okay, good afternoon. Welcome, everyone. It's great to see everyone here. Very exciting to have the first Wednesday seminar of. Do we have some echo there? Is that okay? Okay. First Wednesday seminar of 2024. And so it's my pleasure to introduce Racine Rangel. And Racine is currently a UC President's postdoctoral fellow at UC Santa Cruz, where she's been working with Christy Croker. Racine's an ecophysiologist who uses integrative approaches to study climate change and its effects on coastal marine ecosystems. And in terms of her career path, Racine got her bachelor's degree at the University of Nebraska in Omaha. She then went on to complete her master's at CSU Long Beach, where she studied the physiology of gobies and sculpins. And then Racine continued on to earn her PhD at UC Irvine, where she worked with cascade sorting. And Racine's PhD research focused on multi-stressor effects of ocean acidification and warming, and especially affecting coastal marine invertebrates, and you'll hear about some of that work today. So currently, she's a postdoc with Christy Croker. She's conducting really interesting experiments on ocean acidification effects on red abalone. And it's really exciting to have Racine visiting today. I've always been drawn to Racine's work because it is very integrative. She addresses really important gaps in our understanding of how coastal organisms are responding to climate change, as you'll see in her talk today. So the title of her seminar is Changing Coastlines from Ecology to Physiology, and I will turn it over to you.
So much for you can hear me, right? All right. Thank you so much for that introduction, Eric, and thank you all for being here in person and on Zoom. I'm really excited to be here and share with you some of my past research, some of my current work, and some of my future work that I'm hopefully going to be diving into. So getting into it, maybe we will see. There we go. Great. So here we're looking at a wide array of different aquatic ecosystems. And we know within these systems that there are individuals interacting with their environment, as well as among each other with population and community-level responses. And these all scale up to influence the ecosystem services and functions like we as humans receive from these systems. So as an ecological physiologist, I'm really interested in the overarching question of how does organismal physiology drive ecosystem dynamics? And specifically, I'm interested in how individual-level responses can scale through levels of organization, through population, community, to that ecosystem level, and specifically how individual-level responses can directly influence ecosystem dynamics. So let's focus in on one of these ecosystems. So here we're looking at a beautiful kelp forest, just like one that we would find off of our coastline here in California. And we can focus in on a single individual. So for this individual, we know that they need to consume some type of food, and then that food gets allocated to different physiological processes, things like ion transport, digestion, growth, reproduction. However, when we're thinking about ectothermic species in particular, like the fish that you see pictured here, we know that the environmental conditions that they're in are tied to the rate of these processes occurring. So now we have an idea of how this individual is interacting with their environment, but we know that individuals don't exist within nature in a vacuum. And so there are interactions with other individuals of the same species having these population-level responses and interactions with other species and these community-level interactions. And these all scale to influence the ecosystem, the function, and services in this space. And so now I'm going to briefly touch on my path of how I've kind of been building my skills and going on this journey to answer my overarching question. And so as Eric pointed out, I started off in the middle of the country in Nebraska, and I'm not offended if you've never been there before. I totally understand. But I started diving into understanding how environmental conditions influence individuals by studying the toxicology effects of runoff, agricultural runoff on the fathead minnow that you see pictured here. And then after grad school, or after undergrad, I took a technician position working for Dan Bolnick down at UT Austin before he moved to UConn. However, I actually didn't move to Austin at the beginning of my position at all. I actually moved to Vancouver Island, where I was stationed, and we were studying the evolutionary ecology of three-spined stickleback in glacial lakes there for about the first 6 months of my job working for Dan. And I've been kind of still working in the stickleback world, so we just recently published another paper last year about sneaking behavior in the system of male stickleback. I would be more than happy to talk about this, but I don't have time to get into it today. But after spending some time working with Dan, I was ready to start my graduate school journey. And so that ended up being at Cal State Long Beach, working with Darren Johnson. And here I started really understanding how the environmental conditions can influence the physiology of two different fish species that I'll talk about today. And after my master's program, I knew I still wanted to keep doing research. And so that led me down south a little bit to UC Irvine. But I have a really bad habit of not being able to stay in one place for very long. And so all of my research during my PhD was actually conducted up in Southeast Alaska in Sitka. And here I started expanding and trying to understand how individual level physiological rates can influence these ecosystem level responses in a coastal system. And so that brings me now to my current adventure, where I'm diving deeper into how individual physiological responses are affected by different drivers, thinking about diet and acidification and focusing in on red abalone as a postdoc at UC Santa Cruz. So of course, along my journey, and I'm sure many of us in this room understand that science is not simple, right? Answering my overarching question is not easy because there are multiple pathways in which physiology can be tied to ecosystem dynamic dynamics. And so I'm going to walk you through my overarching framework here. So starting with environmental conditions that can influence an organismal on an organismal level, which can then scale to influence populations, leading to changes in communities, and then scaling to influence ecosystem function and service. And so one of the ways that this framework or pathways can be influenced is through temporal variation, right? Seasonality, changes of environmental conditions over time, as well as resource variation. So the type of food, how much food are individuals consuming, can all alter these pathways in this overall framework. So throughout my research, I've really been focusing in and trying to understand as well as how climate change is a big driver that's altering my overarching framework here. And I've been focusing in on this within marine systems. So today I'm going to touch on a few different stories from my research. A couple of the first stories I'm going to talk about are on an organismal and population level. And then we're going to add in a lot of different variation, looking at a lot of drivers of abiotic and biotic variation, looking at manipulations and tide pools in situ. And then we'll end up discussing a little bit of my current work, trying to understand how resource variation drives changes in this framework, leading to changes in population level responses. So first, we need to talk a little bit about the drivers and changes that are occurring in marine systems. So here are this figure showing you CO2 emissions across our globe. And so our oceans have been doing us quite a big favor for quite some time now, because they've been absorbing about 90% of the excess heat and about 30% of these excess CO2 emissions. So what does this actually mean for our marine systems? Well, we know one of the most prominent changes we're seeing is ocean warming. So here this figure is showing you changes in sea surface temperature from 1901 to 2020. And every single black dot that you see here is a significant increase in sea surface temperature during that range. And climate models are predicting a further increase in sea surface temperature of about 1.7 degrees by the year 2100. We also know another consequence of those CO2 emissions is ocean acidification. So here this figure is showing you the CO2 time series in the North Pacific, with that top red line showing you the increase in those atmospheric CO2 over time. That second green line is showing you the increase of our oceans absorbing those emissions. And then that bottom blue line is showing you the subsequent chemical reaction taking place in our oceans, leading to a decrease in ocean pH over time. So climate models are predicting a further decrease of about 0.16 pH units by the year 2100. All right, so now we have an idea of the different drivers that are influencing our marine systems that I'm going to be talking about today. And so the first framework or timeline that I'm going to talk about is on the organismal scale. And we're going to be focusing in on this story with fishes. So let's talk a little bit about fishes and increasing temperature. Well, like I said before, we know individuals need to consume food, and then that gets allocated to different physiological processes like maintenance, metabolic rate, static growth, or reproduction. And if we add increasing or changing temperature to this equation, we can see a shift in the amount of energy needed to be allocated to processes like maintenance, leaving less for things like growth and reproduction. So it's important to keep in mind that individuals will need to consume more food, right, to offset these costs of increased maintenance and metabolic rates. And so species or populations may respond really differently to changes in temperature. Some fish species can try and mitigate these impacts by moving, but when we're thinking about benthic fishes that don't move long distances after they've settled out, these fish with benthic lifestyles may actually be more vulnerable to things like acute heat waves that we're starting to see take place in our oceans with more frequency. So my first overarching question that I set out to answer was, how does warming impact organismal physiology? So we're going to take a trip down south a little bit to Santa Catalina Island, which is about 20 miles off the coastline and was located near me during my master's at Cal State Long Beach. And not only is it a place to do field work and do research out at, but it's home to a really special and interesting little fish, the blue-banded goby that you see pictured here, or I like to refer to them as the BBG. And they are this vibrant little reef fish. They are very abundant along reefs in California, all the way down into Baja. And they're really interesting in being a simultaneous hermaphrodite. They live in these small groups in a hierarchical society, with the largest individual turning more into the male, and they live in and among the urchin spines on the reefs of Catalina. And they can inhabit anywhere from 6 to 76 meters and experience a range of different temperatures from 5 to 30 degrees C. But when I first set out to study this fish in my master's, I really wanted to continue studying evolution and ecology of fishes, and particularly life history evolution and maternal allocation of resources. And so I started doing that. I started growing gobies in the lab, getting them to lay eggs, hatching them out, trying to get them to settle out. But I wasn't having very much luck, and I started noticing my gobies were coming into the lab. They were very sick when we were collecting them from Catalina, and they would die very quickly in the lab, and it was really frustrating. I didn't know what was going on, and then people kept saying, oh, it's really, like, the water is really warm this time of year. It's really nice. But I had the wonderful pleasure of starting grad school in September of 2014, and I know many of you can already predict what I'm going to say. But what happened was, it was one of the largest marine heat waves that was starting to move through our coastline, and it just stayed there. And in fact, it kept getting bigger to the point where it became called the blob and expanded from Gulf of Alaska down into Baja, California. And so in the middle of my master's program, I really had to make a decision and pivot. And I was like, well, clearly they really don't like changes in temperature. So maybe I should study their physiology. And I went to Darren and was like, hey, can I do this? And he's like, I have no idea how to do it, but go ahead. And I was like, great. And so I started building my physiology skills. I built my first respirometer out of a syringe, an old oxygen probe, and a pump. And I got it to work. And so I brought that data back to Darren and said, I can do this, but I need a better system. And so he said, great, let me buy a respirometer for the lab. And so I was able to continue doing my master's work and kind of pivoted and started working in this new realm of physiology, where I was able to finish data collection on goby physiology and ultimately end up completing my master's. And so I just want to highlight here to the grad students in the room that, you know, sometimes it's really hard when things aren't working out. And I call that, you enter the pit of grad school, but then you can come back out of the pit, and you can come out of that with a whole new range of skills, and that pivoting isn't always bad. It can actually lead you to whole new sections of your research. And so looking at the data that I got from this project, here we have metabolic rate data on the y-axis and increasing temperature on the x. So what we saw was, as predicted, blue-banded goby metabolic rate increased with increasing temperature. So this is what we predicted is their ectotherms. the metabolic rate should increase with increasing temperature. But I wanted to know, what does this actually mean for these gobies on the reefs of Catalina? And so I did a small literature review search, and I tried to find papers that looked at very similar sized benthic reef fishes like the goby. And I calculated using my metabolic rate data a thermal sensitivity or a temperature coefficient or a Q10 value, which is just a biological rate change over a 10 degree change. So using all this information, I found that the goby falls right there where that dotted line is on this figure, and that their temperature sensitivity or Q10 value was 5.21. So most teleost fish fall anywhere around 2.5. So they're definitely more sensitive to temperature change than other teleost fish species. So keeping this information in mind, I still wanted to know, what does this mean for your little goby out there on the reefs of Catalina in their day-to-day lives? So using all of this data, including my metabolic rate data, I set out to understand energy consumption needs of this species. So here in this video, you can see the little blue-banded gobies. When they go to feed, they pop out of the rocks in Catalina or from hiding in the urchin spines, and they dart around the water column, and they really like to eat and mostly make up their diet of a planktonic copepods that you see pictured here. And so using this information with my metabolic rate data, I was able to calculate a minimum daily caloric intake of the blue-banded goby. So now we have maintenance ration on the y-axis and temperature on the x. And so that maintenance ration is just the bare minimum amount of food or energy needed to keep the goby metabolic rate and account for that energy, not accounting for things like growth or reproduction. So for your average goby at 13C, they would need to consume about 180 copepods to maintain their metabolic rate at that temperature. At 16C, that increases to about 250 copepods. And then at 20C, that increases all the way up to 450 copepods. So they'll definitely need to eat a little bit more food in order to just maintain their metabolic rate at these higher temperatures. So from this project, I found that blue-banded goby metabolic rates are relatively sensitive to temperature change. Increased maintenance costs will most likely occur, and they'll need to forage more to offset those costs. But that's only if there is more prey for them to catch, right? So if I were to do this project over again, I would definitely want to see how the prey themselves was being impacted by increasing temperature. So continued warming will likely lead to trade-offs between metabolism and life history traits, things like reproduction, growth, and survival in this species. All right, so now we're going to be leaving Catalina. We're headed back to the mainland to look at the overarching question of how does warming impact populations? We're still going to be looking at this using fish as our example. So the study system here is the California coastline. So here you're looking at an integrated time heat map. And so this is just showing you roughly the water temperature along our coastline when this data was collected. And so most of us know, right, that north of the Southern California Bight, water temperature tends to be cooler. And then down where I was in Long Beach, water temperature tends to be warmer. And so I was grateful to work with some people from USC who had temperature loggers in tide pools in Santa Cruz and Los Angeles County. And using their data, I calculated the range of tide pool temperatures at these two different sites. And so in Santa Cruz, during the hottest summer months, the tide pools were changing roughly 5 degrees, give or take, every day, comparing that to the LA population, which was changing about 10 degrees every day. And so using this as my system, I wanted to find a fish species that lived here to study and look for differences across their biogeographic range. So that led me to studying the woolly sculpin, or the fish that you see pictured here. So this is a really abundant little fish along the California coastline, and they're an intertidal species, and they tend to have these specific home pools that they like to return to during low tide. And it was thought that the larvae, because they spawn in the intertidal, have relatively low dispersal capabilities along the coastline. However, it was also documented that there's high gene flow between populations until you get down into Baja, and then you start to see some genetic structure taking place. So using this fish, I knew I could find them at both locations. And so the first thing I set out to do was measure their metabolic rates, or here I'm showing mass specific oxygen consumption, which is the oxygen consumption rate standardized for the weight of the animal. and then the different temperatures that I tested them at. And the two different colors that you're going to see on this graph are for the LA population, and the open is the Santa Cruz population. But looking at the data here, we can see that there's an increase in metabolic rate, or MO2, with increasing temperature. However, I found that there was no differences among the sites in their mass-specific oxygen consumption. And so instead of calculating a thermal sensitivity for both of these populations separately, I just pooled all the individuals together and calculated a thermal sensitivity of this about 3.02. So definitely less sensitive to temperature change than the goby, falling more closely in line with other teleost fish species. But using this, looking at this data, I wanted to know, okay, there's no differences between sites, but what about, are there differences among individuals within a site? And so using the data structure that we had, I was able to create a sort of repeatability analysis to determine if there was consistent among individual differences between within a site. And so using the random effect structure, we can break that into different components of variance. The one being just random differences among individuals and their activity. They're accounting for tank effects of housing individuals in the same tank. And then the last one is consistent differences among individuals. And so using this variation within our random effect structure, I was able to plot out the amount of among individual variation within the population. So here we have MO2 on that y-axis and then temperature on the x. And so for the LA population, I found that the among individual variation was about 35.2%. So quite high, where individuals are not all responding to increasing temperature the same. When we compare that to the Santa Cruz population, we found that the among individual variation was very low, less than 1%, where there's 36 lines there and they're all falling roughly on the same line. So this is really highlighting that the Los Angeles population has greater among individual variation compared to the Santa Cruz population. So I hope you're probably wondering why. Why would that happen? Well, one of the reasons is that the Los Angeles population just may be more genetically diverse site than the Santa Cruz population. And I really want to highlight here that this most likely has to play, or is happening due to our California currents likely playing a really large role in moving larvae along the coastline, where we're getting larvae coming up from Baja, as well as coming from down, the California coastline from Northern California. And so when we're thinking about these two different species, they can have varying sensitivities to temperature. So differences in habitat size and population dynamics may lead to varying outcomes, and that there is importance of looking and understanding how among individual physiological responses may influence life history trade-offs. And so looking forward, I'm excited to continue trying to understand and using fish with varying life history strategies and lifestyles to kind of start understanding how these physiological responses may be changing, thinking about these small benthic fishes. So during my master's, I learned some really valuable lessons, like science doesn't always know how you plan, and I got to work with some really interesting fish that you see pictured here. But I knew that I was studying all of this within a lab setting, right? I was bringing individuals in, having them housed at controlled conditions within the lab. And so for my PhD, I knew that I wanted to incorporate more of the abiotic and biotic variation, because we know that they're not housed in normal environmental conditions that stay really constant in a tide pool. They're dealing with changes in temperature and pH and vast amounts. And so that leads me to my next question, where now we're going to start incorporating a wide array of different abiotic and biotic variation, asking the overarching question, how does warming and acidification impact coastal ecosystems? And I'm leaving the vertebrate world behind, and I'm now moving into the world of invertebrates, and so we're going to be focusing on mussels. So for the study system for this project, it's the intertidal coastal system in Sitka, Alaska. This is a picture of our site there. It's called John Brown's Beach. And so at this field site, we really wanted to test the effects of climate change on this ecosystem. And so we conducted a 6-month long factorial field manipulation. So we had 4 different treatments with 20 pools total. We had pools that were unmanipulated, pools that were warmed, pools that had CO2 added to them, and then pools that were, had CO2 added plus were warmed. And the color scheme that you see here is going to remain. I really hope you're trying to picture to yourself right now, what does this look like in a tide pool? It required a ton of hardware. So here's one of our pools. So here we had batteries, which were about 9-pound motorcycle batteries. And they powered this heater bar, which was anchored into the bottom of the tide pool. And then we had this little CO2 generator, which was yeast that you bake with, sugar, bicarbonate, and some warm water. It was all mixed together, creating this little microbrewery, essentially, producing CO2, which was then bubbled from that generator into our tide pool. So here's a video showing you the CO2 bubbling out of one of the air stones, so for one of our CO2 pools. Here's a close-up of what one of our heater bars looked like anchored into the bottom of the pool. So as you can imagine, this project was a part of a much larger collaboration where we were monitoring the environmental conditions, the water chemistry in the pools, tracking community changes. And so I just want to give a shout out to my collaborators here, Drs. Cascade Sorti and Matt Bracken at UC Irvine. Christy Croker, this is where Christy and I started collaborating together at UC Santa Cruz, and then Luke Miller down at San Diego State University. So looking at this project, I was like, oh, no one's looking at this through a physiological lens. Can I tag myself onto this project and kind of try and understand how the physiology of these species are dealing with these climate change manipulations? And so my role in here was focusing in on mussels that you see pictured here, and specifically the Pacific blue mussel, or Mytilus chocyllus. And I picked this species because they're a foundation species. So they create valuable habitat for other species within the intertidal. And when we look at the breakdown of the percent cover of our sessile community in our pools, Mytilus chocyllus is the most abundant sessile animal and the most abundant calcifying species. So when we're thinking about these dominant species or space holders in coastal systems, some potential effects of acidification and warming on these organisms, like I already pointed out in my talk, is increased metabolism, increased energy demands, increased growth. But when we're thinking about animals like mussels that build their shells or skeletons with calcium carbonate, we may see a decrease in their ability to calcify or ability to make and repair their shells that you see pictured here with these two mussel shells held at different pH. And again, I want to highlight the importance of food. So Melsner et al. In 2013 did a really cool study where they were looking at effects of declining pH on the amount of nacre or shell that's dissolving. And in high food treatment, individuals were able to kind of handle the negative impacts of acidification alone. So highlighting this, how food is a very important player when we're thinking about these effects of acidification and warming on species. Then when we're thinking about effects of acidification and warming on populations, we actually saw the effects of this just a few years ago along our coastline, where marine heat waves came through and just decimated populations of mussels that you see pictured here along our coastlines. And so this led to rapid decreases and changes in survival and population abundance. And so this ultimately leads to changes in community interactions as well along our coastline. So when we're scaling all of this up and thinking about ecosystem function, mussels are really important because they're dominant calcifiers in coastal intertidal systems. They help maintain net ecosystem calcification, or NEC, through the calcification of their shells. And so for those of you maybe not familiar with net ecosystem calcification, this is the rate at which calcium carbonate is transformed from its aqueous to its solid form, so the building of those mussel shells. And so if a system is in positive calcification or net calcification, you would assume that individuals are able to grow, they're able to build their shells and get bigger. Whereas if a system is in net dissolution, this would mean individuals are not able to grow as big, maybe their shells are corroding and going back into that aqueous form. So looking at our ecosystem function first, of net ecosystem calcification, we're going to just take a look at how our climate manipulations alter this. So here we have net ecosystem calcification on the y-axis. And as a reminder, more positive values mean net calcification, where more negative values mean net dissolution. And then we have the different months that we were running this experiment. So the first panel that I'm going to show you is before we turned on any of those manipulations. So here we can see this is during March here, And I want to highlight here that net calcification is increasing during the year. Okay? And so now we're going to move into May. And so now we've turned on those climate change manipulations. And so we're still seeing a similar pattern, but it's just getting bigger, right? And this makes sense. So now when we're in Sitka, water temperature is starting to get warmer, growing season is starting to ramp up in our tide pools, net calcification is still increasing during the daytime. And then we enter our hottest months in Alaska, in our tide pool system, in June and July. And I want you to focus in on the yellow box that I have highlighted here. So here we can see that during the, with the addition of CO2 into these pools, they exhibited dissolution both during the daytime and the nighttime during these months. And so now we're no longer just seeing increased calcification during the day. And so then when we enter back into August, our water temperatures are starting to decrease in our pools and things are starting to kind of go back to normal. So this is showing us how our net ecosystem function was being influenced by our climate manipulations. Let's take a look at how the communities were being affected. We're looking at the community structure of our tide pools under these manipulations, and this is an NMDS plot. And so this is just showing the sessile community structure in our tide pools. And I really want to highlight here that we didn't see large shifts in community structure, just these minor changes where treatment was influencing our tide pools, but this was most likely due to the fact that we had high amounts of calcifiers in our CO2 addition pools and high amounts of the most abundant seaweed species in our pools. And so any reduction that we're seeing in net calcification, net ecosystem calcification, is wouldn't be explained by reductions in mussel or our calcifying species abundance. Now we have an idea of our ecosystem function being influenced and now our community level responses. So let's look at our individual level response. So here we have individual mussel mass specific oxygen consumption on the y-axis and then our different treatments on the x-axis. And so I found that individual metabolic rates increased in those CO2 added pools, which is highlighted by that dark gray box that you see there. So this is suggesting that there's likely a physiological cost being associated with being in these high CO2 environment. So using this, all this information, both the individual level response and the ecosystem function, we can see how individual level responses are directly leading to changes. So here we have net ecosystem calcification on the y-axis again, and then that individual mass-specific oxygen consumption of the muscle. And I'm only going to be touching on the daytime values right now for the sake of time today. So what we expected to find and what we saw was as metabolic rates increased, net ecosystem calcification also increased under ambient CO2 levels. And this is highlighted by these solid arrows that you see here. Individuals are growing, they're building their shells, their metabolic rates are increasing. This is what we expected to see. However, when we added CO2 to these pools, we actually saw a shift now where net ecosystem calcification is decreasing under these CO2 added conditions. And this is highlighted by these dashed arrows that you see here. So even though these individuals have high or increased metabolic demands, we're still seeing a decrease in overall net ecosystem calcification in these pools. So this is highlighting how these individuals were most likely under a chronic stress, but not a lethal stress, and that this is directly impacting ecosystem function. And then next, we can look at how our population level responses are being influenced. So now we have net ecosystem calcification on the y-axis and increasing mussel percent cover on the x. And again, just focusing on the daytime values here. And so what we expected to see and what we found was as mussel abundance increased, net ecosystem calcification also increased under ambient CO2 levels, again highlighted by those solid arrows that you see there. So with more calcifying mussels in the pools, we were getting more positive values of net ecosystem calcification. However, when we added CO2 to these pools again, we see a shift. So now regardless of having pools with really high amounts of calcifying mussels in the pools, we're seeing a decrease in net ecosystem calcification. So again, this is really highlighting how individual organismal physiology and having this higher metabolic rate is still leading to this lower calcification, leading to a decrease in net ecosystem calcification in these tide pools. So thinking about this system and this project, I found that changes on ecosystem function are occurring through populations by this per capita individual level rate. However, I do want to stress that there's most likely going to be continued change in community structure. If we were to run this study a little bit longer, maybe for a year, we would see that as those metabolic thresholds are surpassed, we'd start to see larger shifts in community structure. So looking forward, I feel like this project really highlights how we can manipulate tide pools as systems to help us better understand the emergent effects of systems while incorporating all of this abiotic and biotic variation, and looking at understanding how to determine vulnerability in other ecosystem services and valuable ecosystem engineering. So towards the end of my PhD, I knew that I really wanted to continue adding to this framework, but I wanted to better understand how we as people could be added to it and what is the interaction that takes place there. And so I had the really wonderful pleasure of, during my PhD in the last year, I got to do an internship through Minorities in Aquaculture, or MIA, which is an organization that was created by my friend Amani Black, and it's to help build stronger connections, one, increasing the diversity, gender and racial diversity of the blue economy, specifically in the East Coast area, but now moving into the West Coast, but also strengthening connections between academia and the blue economy. And so I just went out there and worked on predominantly women-owned farms for about almost 3 months. And I just got to learn the inner workings of what it takes to run a farm and had these conversations with farmers. What do you need from scientists? What kind of struggles are you having? How is increasing temperature impacting you on a day-to-day? And how can we start building those connections now? And so it was a really wonderful experience, and I got to work with a wide array of different farmers, and they all run their farm differently, just like all of us scientists do our thing a little bit differently. And so it was a wonderful experience, and that led me into building my postdoc work off of this. And so that brings me to abalone of the West Coast, which I know many of you are very familiar with here. And so, as we know, in the late 1960s to early 1980s, we started to see abalone numbers and populations starting to decrease rapidly off of our coastline due to declines in health, low recruitment rates, density of adults. We started to see continued loss of individuals along our coastline, and the red abalone was really the last man kind of standing, where there was still a recreational fishery open to collect them. However, that closed in 2018 with no sunset on that program as of now. And so this brings us to this really interesting cross-section of that we must now rely on aquaculture to obtain individual abalone, and giving us a unique picture of what this means for academia or research and farmers themselves. And so there are a lot of different reasons why this occurred, right? And so here, this figure showing us the changes in kelp cover starting in 2008 and moving through that blob years, right? So I definitely feel like I was also having a terrible time in my master's during this time, and the abalone were clearly also having an awful time where all of their food was being removed and losing their food sources in the ocean. So this kind of perfect storm of loss of abalone food, changing environmental conditions, disease, harvesting pressure, all led to this decrease in abalone populations. And scientists were on the ball trying to understand, you know, why is this taking place? And one of the ways that we can answer this question or understand what's happening is looking at the complex life cycle that species like abalone have. And this allows us to test across different life stages and generations to identify adaptive mechanisms under changing environmental conditions that you see pictured here, the life cycle of the red abalone. And so researchers and collaborators here at VML, Dan Sweezy and others in 2020 published a really amazing study which highlighted that under high CO2, lipid provisioning is a predictor of survival. And so this is really highlighting the importance of this parental investment in this species as a mechanism to potentially increase survival and conservation efforts. And so that led me to trying to understand more the effects of transgenerational plasticity, or TGP. So this is the environmental conditions experienced by parents that may positively or negatively influence the phenotype of the offspring, but this is through a non-genetic change. And this can occur through different mechanisms. So some being hormones or proteins or epigenetic marks like DNA methylation. But the one that I'm really interested in is this nutritional provisioning and how this can lead to changes in offspring. So reflecting back on my framework here and looking at abalone now, I'm adding in how resource variation can lead to changes in population when we're thinking about changing environmental conditions, but I'm also adding to this framework now and thinking about how plasticity and adaptation interactions can influence as well. So for my current work, I'm trying to answer two overarching questions. One, does diet influence capital investment under high CO2 conditions? Can we identify adaptive mechanisms for more climate resilient abalone offspring? So again, as you can imagine, this is a much collaborative project with Christy and I at UC Santa Cruz, the cultured abalone farm down outside of Santa Barbara, and then researchers here at UC Davis, including Dan Sweezy. So for these adaptive mechanisms, my project is up and running. We're in the middle of it right now. And so I have the parental abalone are being held at two different CO2 conditions, and they're getting fed three different diet treatments. So in a month or so, I'm going to hopefully do a spawn that's successful, or a couple spawns that are successful. And I'm going to grow out the larvae and measure a whole slew of different traits, things like growth, calcification, thermal tolerance, survival. So here's some sneak peek pictures of our setup down at Santa Cruz in our mesocosm system that you see here. So all of the abalone get their own little condo. And yes, it is the cheapest rent in all of Santa Cruz County. And they get fed their little diets through a hole in the top of the bucket. And then we collect all of their feces and everything during this time period. So projected outcomes from this project are to hopefully be able to detect effects of individual resource variation on physiological rates and calcification, as well as help us determine if transgenerational plasticity can help create resilience for abalone populations across generations. So looking forward and adding to my framework, I'm interested in trying to understand and conducting more of these long-term field manipulations, asking the overarching question, how will communities and key species interactions be reshaped under climate change? As well as thinking about how variable environmental conditions changing, right? Seasonality and how this plays a role here, asking the question, how does increasing variability in environmental conditions influence ecosystem dynamics? Finally, thinking about how resource variation and seasonal mismatches of those can influence. And asking the question, are there windows of vulnerability and resiliency across these seasonal times? And so I plan to do a combination of through my work, which I'm already doing, of both field-based studies and lab-based studies, and highlighting my undergraduates that you see here working on feeding all of the abalone. And so looking forward, I plan to continue trying to answer my overarching question of how does organismal physiology drive ecosystem dynamics? But a part of my research is that I really aim to increase the recruitment and underrepresented scientists within the marine sciences specifically. And so I utilize four different main approaches to do that, being student-centered mentoring, highlighting the students that have helped me work on the projects that I talked about today, but also thinking about inclusive and experiential teaching. I've had the great pleasure of working at institutions that really take pride and highlight the importance of hands-on training for undergraduates at Cal State Long Beach, UCI, and now at UC Santa Cruz. And having that connection between actually doing the science as part of a field course and then applying it in their own research projects later on is just so important in retaining underrepresented individuals in STEM, as well as incorporating and bolstering my students' and mentees' identity, accessibility, and inclusivity. So these are some of the entities and groups that I'm a part of and will continue to be a part of to kind of increase our network of recruiting individuals into the marine sciences, as well as creating opportunities. We know that in order to recruit and retain these individuals within the STEM field, one large barrier to that is finance, right? So it's really expensive to do marine science, both just field work, but when we're thinking about diving, diving is incredibly expensive and a big barrier for many students. I myself struggled with this during my master's, where sometimes I had to decide, if I was going to get my gear serviced, if I was going to pay my rent, or as if I was going to pay buy groceries. And so being able to utilize programs and make sure that those programs continue on to help offset those financial burdens for students, like some of the projects that we have at UC Santa Cruz now, is something that I'm really interested in and focusing on as I move through my postdoc work. All right, and of course, none of this work would not have ever happened without all of my wonderful collaborators and all of the thank yous. There's so many people I couldn't fit on all of these slides, but everybody who's helped on the Sitka project, it was really massive, and it took a lot to carry those batteries every single day into the tide pools, and we all fell a lot, but we're okay, and we made it. And I just want to thank all of my funding sources for supporting my research as I've moved forward throughout my career. I'll just say thank you, and I'll take any questions.
Thank you, Racine. So people who are attending remotely on Zoom, you're welcome to type any questions into the question and answer box, and I will intersperse those questions periodically. But let's start, are there any questions here? Sam, and I'll just remind people to please speak into the box so people on Zoom can hear.
Thanks, Christine. That was awesome. The type book term was super cool. But I have a question about the Sculpin results. I was a little surprised that the variation in LA was so was so high, especially because I, from what I understand, like the LA area is a much less thermally variable environment compared to Santa Cruz. And so I'm wondering, like, is this a case of dispersal working against like the direction of the environment? Terms of like selection, or whether this, whether I don't understand oceanography.
These were things that I thought about a lot, so don't feel bad. Yeah, I do think it is a lot about dispersal, and that we just don't have a lot of the papers that were looking at Sculpin genetic structure were from like the 1980s. I don't think anybody's looked at it since then in depth, and so that could be exactly what it is. It's just this effect. But what we found using the tide pool data from my colleagues at USC was that the tide pools at White's Point that I collected from were changing more on a day-to-day basis than our pools in Santa Cruz. So I feel like this was a conversation we had earlier where location and your site can really influence your findings. And so I do think another thing would have been to add a couple more sites to this study to see if we see that same pattern or if it was just
a one. Seen awesome talk. That tide pool experiment you guys did in Alaska was crazy and awesome. Like, yeah, wow. So I think I noticed that your warming plus CO2 treatments seem to have higher net calcification than your CO2 alone. Can you talk a little bit about that result, and was it expected or unexpected? Or I guess I thought that maybe it would be worse, so worse, I don't know.
Yeah. I know, so did I. yeah, the warming plus CO2, I didn't have time to get into it today, but I also have measured a whole slew of different shell traits on the muscles too, and it's always consistent that the warming plus CO2 effect seemed to be falling in between the CO2 warming pools, so that there was a mitigating effect that was taking place. And it was really interesting and not at all what I expected to find. And one thing I think what's driving that was that our tide pool, the warming entity, wasn't super strong, just because we probably needed even more motorcycle batteries, but we literally couldn't carry that many to actually increase it by a lot. So we only increased it about 1.4 degrees. And so it was just like a little bit extra warming. And I think having it just be a moderate warming seemed to actually be more beneficial, the gating effect overall. Yeah, really interesting.
Really great talk. My question was, I always assume that invertebrates have a higher experiment, but that for.
Did do that, in fact, in my first study, in my first chapter of my PhD. So I have an individual variation of hermit crabs, snails, and mussels before we turned on any of the manipulation. And the mussels actually had the lowest amount of individual variation, then the snails, and then the hermit crabs had the highest amount of individual variation. One of the things I thought was really driving that was changes, differences in the mobility of the species. Which was something I was interested in continuing. I have enough time to add another study onto my PhD. But yeah, so it was higher than, it was a little bit higher than the sculpin in among individuals, but not by much. So yeah, very interesting. But I wasn't planning on looking at that in the abalone, but I think I will after adding here.
I had a question about your muscle project when this question about why you saw more. And measures the amount of food available in the tadpoles, and I think that if they're living closer to their upper limit of sand, will that change more food available?
Yeah, I wish we'd measured food availability, but we didn't. I tried to go back and get like chlorophyll A measurements, but they weren't anywhere close enough for our site. That could definitely be a driver. But one thing that I did do is I did do some thermal tolerance assays with the mussels. And so I knew that their thermal tolerance ranges were about 34 degrees C. And we had temperature data logged every 5 minutes in our pools, and they never got near that level, even during the summer. But I definitely think, you know, it's hard to say specifically without looking at the system or doing a study. I think no matter what, if you reach those physiological limits, there's food can only get you so far. And so you would probably still see decreases in survival and then ultimately changes in population abundance as well.
So we have a couple questions online. One of the questions is the same question that Anya already asked. So that was about the muted response of the multi-stress. So I think you addressed that. There's another question here about how does genetic variation, for example, within the mussel populations we study, in the tidal environment affect responses of marine life to climate?
Yeah, I wish we also looked at genetic variation, but we did not. I would imagine that, I know for Trochilus that there tends to not be very high levels of genetic structures, specifically in our field or in the Sitka area that we were working in, but it could definitely be a factor, and it could definitely be influencing how individuals are responding to the treatment. So I think, ideally, we would do this again and collect that data and really look at, is genetic variation the strong component? But I definitely think especially in my muscle shell measurements that I looked at, thinking about how variation among individuals and populations could influence their shell building capabilities as well.
What up, Racine? That was a great talk. Your experiment in Alaska is fire, literally. So question about that. What was the mortality like in general? I know you did like really
our high up, pools?
Yeah. Was it like super high or was it, you know?
Yeah, so we didn't see any changes in population abundance of the mussels throughout our experiment, at least no significant changes. We did have two of our tide pools where everything died, and they were our two pools at our highest levels, and one was a CO2 added, and one was our CO2 added plus warming. So I think that was a really interesting effect, that those being the highest in the tide height, so they didn't get flushed every single day like our other tide pools did. And so I think that really highlights that under these stressors and kind of getting at Maya's question of once you pass those physiological thresholds, you just see sharp decreases in survival. So we did see that, but overall, over the whole 6 months, we didn't see any significant abundance of the mussels. I didn't do any in lab work with the pH treatments, but there has to be. One of the things I think to keep in mind is that the system got reset every time the tide came in. So we're still seeing these super strong effects, even though the pools got flushed with fresh seawater that wasn't being influenced. And then we also programmed the heaters to turn off during high tide so that they were only using battery and turning on during low tide. So again, I think if we ran the experiment longer, we'd start to be able to see those effects. But 6 months was kind of like a, we didn't think we'd get there and we still did. So doing it again for longer, I think will give us be able to allow us to start teasing apart those mechanisms. Yeah.
So we'll take one final question from online. And the question is whether, for your current work, whether you have any hypotheses for your transgenerational plasticity work on abalone?
Yeah, great question. I definitely am hypothesizing. So the abalone are getting fed three different diet treatments, and one is a mixed diet treatment of two different seaweed species. And so I'm predicting that having a mixed diet is going to be the most beneficial, and that we'll see higher amounts of lipid content in those eggs and potentially higher survival and higher thermal tolerance of the offspring from those parental.
Okay, so I just wanted to remind everyone that BML is now sponsoring a new relaxation hour from 4:30 to 5:30 with fresh refreshments and snacks. So if you're around and want to come, everyone here is invited. It's fine if you can just stop in for a few minutes or if you want to stay the whole time, but everyone's invited. And let's thank Racine again for a great seminar. And thank you to everyone online for attending as well.